वेलकम एवरी वन, आई एम अतिया रहीम, आई एम अ विजिटिंग फैकल्टी मेम्बर इन डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश. इन दिस सेशन वी हैव अ कोर्स फॉर BS ऑनर्स नेम एज 19th सेंचुरी इंग्लिश नॉवल एंड कोर्स कोड इज 3114. आई होप यू ऑल आर फाइन. नाउ लेट्स स्टार्ट आवर स्टडी सेशन. इन दिस लेक्चर वी हैव अ समरी एंड एनालिसिस ऑफ चैप्टर्स फ्रॉम 26 टू ऑनवर्ड्स. Chapter 26 of the novel, Emma arrives at the Cole's party behind Mr. Knightley. Because Knightley usually walks, Emma is surprised that he has come in his carriage. At dinner, it is revealed that Jane Fairfax has received the mysterious gift of a pianoforte. People assume that piano is from Campbell, but Emma tells Frank she suspects it is a gift from Mr. Dixon. When Jane arrives later, she blushes when questioned about the piano. Meanwhile, Mrs. Weston tells Emma that Mr. Knightley brought his carriage so that he could convey Jane home. Mrs. Weston suggests that a match may be forming between Jane and Mr. Knightley, but Emma resists this supposition vigorously, explaining that she cannot bear the thought of Mr. Knightley marrying because her nephew George and Isabella's son Henry will not be able to inherit Downwell Abbey. Downwell Abbey is the estate of Knightley, the town of the same name. Mrs. Weston suspects that Mr. Knightley is the one who sent Jane the pianoforte. Emma and Jane sing and play the piano for the company with Frank. When Frank persuades Jane to sing one more song, Mr. Knightley intervenes. Emma questions Mr. Knightley about the piano and the carriage. His answers convince her that he did not send the gift but do not enable her to decide if he has feelings for Jane or not. After the dance, she is relieved that he does not ask Jane for dance. Emma is also pleased that Frank immediately asks her and not Jane for the dance. There is time for only two dances. However, before the party breaks up, Frank comments to Emma that he is lucky the dancing had to end. Otherwise, he would have found himself asking Jane Fairfax for a dance. Chapter 27 of the novel, Emma is thoroughly pleased with her evening at the Coles, but she is uncertain about the appropriateness of telling Frank about her suspicions about Jane or acknowledging the superiority of Jane's musical abilities. At the Coles party, Harriet hears that Mr. Martin had dined with the Cox family, and there is a rumor that a Cox daughter would like to marry Mr. Martin. To distract and protect Harriet, Emma accompanies her on a shopping trip. They then decide to pay a visit to the Bates household. But Miss Bates then comes into the shop to ask Emma to come give her opinion of Jane's new pianoforte. In her rambling, Miss Bates reveals that Mr. Knightley has sent his last apples of the season to Jane, who is particularly fond of them. Chapter 28. In this chapter, Emma enters the Bates sitting room and finds Frank occupied with fixing Mrs. Bates' glasses and Jane seated at the piano. Frank asks Jane questions about how she feels or imagines the piano came to her, and his comment, "True affection only could have prompted it," makes Jane blush. Believing that Frank is teasing Jane unkindly about Mr. Dixon, Emma whispers that he should stop, and she regrets that having shared her speculations about Jane with him. Mr. Knightley stops by to check on Jane's health but refuses to come in when he hears that Frank is there. Chapter 29. In this chapter, Woodhouses are visiting Randalls. Frank and Emma work on planning a ball so they can finish the dance inaugurated at the Cools. They decide the room at Randalls is too small. Mr. Woodhouse privately tells Mrs. Weston his concern that Frank is so thoughtless about opening and shutting doors that he exposes Emma, Harriet, and Mrs. Weston to danger traps. The next solution proposed by Frank on behalf of Mr. Weston is that the ball be given at the Crown Inn. Frank does a poor job reassuring Mr. Woodhouse that his plan will not give them all colds. Emma comforts her father and she agrees to the plan. There are further practical difficulties and Frank proposes to go and fetch Mrs. Bates along with her niece Jane Fairfax, whom Frank admits he does not immediately recollect, for advice. By the time he returns, the difficulties have been resolved, the date of the ball has been set, and Frank secures from Emma a promise to dance the first two dances with him. Chapter 30. In this chapter, Emma is worried that Frank's aunt, Mrs. Churchill, will refuse Frank permission to stay on for the ball, which is scheduled for a few days after his visit is scheduled to end. To everyone's relief, he receives this permission. Only Mr. Knightley refuses to look forward to the ball. He does not seem interested in dancing. Emma takes Knightley's diffidence as further proof that he is not interested in Jane, who, in a rare moment of openness, confesses how much she looks forward to the ball. 2 days later, Frank is called back because his aunt is ill. The ball is postponed definitely, and Frank comes to Emma to say goodbye. Frank departs and Emma is depressed. She concludes that she must be a little in love with Frank after all. Chapter 31. In this chapter, Emma imagines the course that her and Frank's love affair will run. In her mind, her fantasy always ends with her refusing Frank. She believes she loves him, but not so much, and Frank's feelings are changeable. She reads his first letter to Mrs. Weston after returning and admires the warm feelings Frank expresses for Highbury. His brief mention of Harriet makes Emma speculate that Harriet could replace her. After that, village gossip turns to Mr. Elton, who will soon arrive in Highbury with his new bride. Harriet is flustered by the prospect of Elton's return, and Emma suggests that if Harriet will not forget Elton for her own sake, she should do for Emma. Harriet repents and Emma is moved by the warmth of Harriet's love for her. Chapter 32. In this chapter, Mr. Elton returns with his bride and Emma decides that she and Harriet should visit the newlyweds early on in order to re-establish normal social relation. In this first meeting, Emma reserves judgment on Mrs. Elton and attributes Mr. Elton's lack of ease for the awkwardness of the situation. When the couple returns the visit and comes to Hartfield, Emma is able to observe Mrs. Elton at greater length, and Emma is horrified by the over-familiarity of her manners. Mrs. Elton is attached to superficial token of wealth, such as her sister and brother-in-law's carriage. She presumes to take Emma under her social wing, and she prides herself on the inner resources of self-worth and foresight that she clearly lacks. Chapter 33. In this chapter, Emma continues to dislike Mrs. Elton, who, noting Emma's reserve, begins to return the sentiment. Emma assumes that Mr. Elton has told his wife something of the unfortunate episode with her and Harriet, to whom the Eltons are specially rude. Mrs. Elton takes on Jane Fairfax as her project, attempting to bring her out socially. Emma is puzzled that Jane refuses another invitation to join Mr. and Mrs. Campbell and Mr. and Mrs. Dixon in Ireland. She is also puzzled that Jane accepts Mrs. Elton's attention, and she discusses Jane's action with Mrs. Weston and with Mr. Knightley. Mr. Knightley defends Jane's acceptance of Mrs. Elton's attention. After that, Emma takes the opportunity to probe Mr. Knightley on his feelings for Jane, telling him the extent of your admiration may take you by surprises one day or other. Knightley seems flustered and uneasy and embarrassed. He insists her that he is not in love with Jane, but Emma is satisfied that she has been right about Knightley's feelings for Jane. Chapter 34. In this chapter, we see, fulfilling a social obligation, Emma plans a dinner party for Mrs. Elton. Harriet asks to be excused from attending, which gives Emma the opportunity to ease her belief regarding Jane Fairfax, who at Harriet's announced absence is invited to fill the empty 8th seat. Mr. Knightley is also included because he will be in Highbury. At the party, Mr. John Knightley gently reapproaches Jane for fetching letters from the post office that morning in the rain. Jane acts as if the situation is not a big deal, but ends up blushing and watery-eyed, and soon the rest of the party begins discussing the matter. Mrs. Elton insists that her servant should be given the task of Jane's letter, and Jane firmly resists. After that, the conversation moves to the handwriting. Mr. Knightley praises Emma's penmanship, but dissents when she praises the penmanship of Frank Churchill. Jane's eagerness to fetch her own letters rouses Emma's suspense, but she decides not to trouble Jane by asking questions. Chapter 35. In this chapter, the women gather in the drawing room after dinner, and Mrs. Elton pursues the subject of letter retrieval with Jane. She also insists on helping Jane find a governess position, but Jane explains she will not seek a place until after she sees The Compels in Midsummer. The men come in, and Mr. Weston, who has been on business in London, appears. He brings a letter from Frank, reporting that Mrs. Churchill has decided that the household should make an extended visit in London. This news means that Frank will be able to be Highbury a good deal. Mr. and Mrs. Weston are pleased. Emma is somewhat agitating, and Mr. Knightley seems unexcited by the news. Chapter 36. In this chapter, Mr. Weston and Mrs. Elton have a long-winded conversation in which they pursue comically different purposes. Mrs. Elton fishes for compliments and goes on about Maple Grove. Maple Grove is the state where her wealthy brother and sister-in-law live. Mr. Weston talks about Frank and explains the illness of Frank's aunt, Mrs. Churchill. Before the conversation becomes too heated, they are interrupted by tea. After that, Mr. John Knightley appears and he asks Emma, "Can you manage the children now that you are a social butterfly?" And Emma replied, "I am more than up for the job." In chapter 37 of Emma realizes that whatever attachment she had with Frank has succeeded. She feels such apprehension more on his behalf than her own. She has no doubt as his being less in love as well. Because of his aunt's demand, Frank is kept away for 10 days after his first visit. Mrs. Churchill eventually determines that her family must move from London to Richmond, which places Frank closer to Highbury. Mr. Weston is delighted to have his son nearer. At the end of the chapter, a date is set for the long postponed ball. In chapter 38 of Emma, the day of the ball arrives. Emma is invited by Mr. Weston to come early and give her opinion on the arrangements. Emma believes that this opportunity will give some privacy to her second meeting with Frank. Mrs. Elton claims on the day of ball, "I will lead the dancers with Mr. Weston." Mr. Knightley stands aside, not interested in dancing, and watches Emma as she dancing on the floor. As narrator says, his tall, firm, upright figure was such as Emma felt must draw everybody's eye and accepting her own partner. At one point, Harriet is awkward without her partner. Mrs. Weston sees Mr. Elton free and argues him, "You should ask Harriet to dance." Mr. Elton replied liberally, "No." Mr. Knightley comes to her and rescues her by dancing with her. Emma and Harriet are both grateful when Mr. Knightley smiles at Emma and never catches her for eye. The nonverbal communication between them shows how much there is sympathy. Emma is pleased with him. Later, she expresses her gratitude and he asks her why the Eltons are her enemies. She admits that she wants to marry Harriet. Knightley, in return, admits that Harriet has more admirable qualities than he originally thought. At the end of the chapter, Emma and Knightley bound their new mutual understanding with the dance. Chapter 39. In this chapter, Emma reflects on what happened at the ball and concludes that Mr. Elton was not the superior creature she had believed him. But her thought interrupted when Frank walks in with Harriet. He says he came upon her on the road just in time to rescue her from a band of gypsies demanding money. Frank happened to be walking along and frightened the gypsies away. Emma cannot help but wonder whether this romantic circumstance might make Harriet and Frank interesting to each other. In chapter 40 of the novel, a few days later, Harriet comes to Emma and she shows Emma a bit of court plaster. Court plaster used at the time as a bandage that she had lent to Mr. Elton when he cut himself. She tells her friend that she plans to burn these mementos as a symbol of moving on. When Harriet comes to Emma to burn these cherished mementos, Emma feels shame, wonder, and amusement. As narrator says, but she relieved that Harriet is ready to move on for Mr. Elton. Harriet says to Emma that she will never marry, but she confesses she has feelings for another man who is out of her reach. Emma believes that he is Frank Churchill. She advises Harriet to be cautious while Harriet is talking about someone else. Chapter 41. In this chapter, Mr. Knightley begins to suspect that there is some secret understanding between Jane and Frank. During a walk with Emma, Harriet, Mr. and Mrs. Weston, Frank, Jane and Miss Bates, Knightley witnesses a strange exchange between them. As gathering goes indoor, Frank plays a word game with Emma and Jane. For Jane, he jumbled the letter blunder, and for Emma, he jumbled the letter Dixon. When she spells it out, he shows it to Jane and she gets angry. When the party breaks up, Knightley stays behind to speak to Emma. He knows that everyone considered her the object of Frank's affection. Knightley asks Emma about the Dixon joke and embarrassed, she refuses to explain. Knightley tells her his suspect about Jane and Frank. Emma laughs at him and gives answer to him by telling Frank's indifference to Jane. Knightley is silenced and irritated by Emma's implication that she is in Frank's confidence. Chapter 42. In this chapter, the gentry of Hybrae decides outing to the Box Hill, but it has to be postponed because of a lame horse. Mr. Knightley half jokingly suggests that the party come to his estate instead. Mrs. Elton seizes upon the idea, and Knightley has to be firm to prevent her from planning all the details. Meanwhile, the lame horse heals, and it is decided that the Box Hill party will follow the one at Downwell Abbey, the Knightley estate. At Downwell Abbey, Emma enjoys examining Knightley's house and grounds. She remarks, "It was sweet view, sweet to the eye and to the mind." She then encountered a destroyed Jane, who plans to leave early and walk home alone. Clearly, a lover's quarrel has taken place and nobody recognizes as such yet. At first, Emma insists her on a carriage, but then she agrees to Jane's decision to leave by herself. But at the last minute, Frank shows up, but he seems to be in a horrible mood. Chapter 43. In this chapter, we come to know that the Box Hill picnic party is not a success. When people are separated in parties, the Eltons are one party, Westons and Mr. Woodhouse are another party. Mr. Knightley stays with Jane and Miss Bates. Frank, Harriet, Emma form their own party. On top of this, Frank's bad mood totally infects Emma and brings her down. She is totally disappointed by Harriet's and Frank's dullness. Later, Frank becomes lively. The party sits about listlessly, and Frank says that Emma demands to know what they are thinking of. The Eltons are still angry at Emma and Harriet, and Jane and Frank are seem to be very nasty lovers fighter. Frank begins openly flirting with Emma, and she responds to him mostly because she is terribly out of sort. Emma senses that his flirtation has no meaning, but she is unaware that he is using her as a weapon. Frank exchanging angry words with Jane and informing that he did not really know who she was. At one point, he demands a piece of cleverness from each member of the party. At this, Miss Bates good-natured comments that the last requirements, but Emma responds, "Ma'am, but there may be a difficulty. Pardon me, but you will be limited as to number, only 3 at once." Mr. Weston offers an enigma in praise of Emma, and the Eltons leave in disgust for a walk. Frank comments that sometimes matches made in public places become regrettable on further acquaintance, and that as a result, Mr. and Mrs. Elton are lucky that they are compatible. Jane leaves for a walk with anger, and Emma left Frank grows tired of his flirty. Later, Mr. Knightley takes Emma aside and blames her for conduct towards Miss Bates, reminding that Miss Bates has had an unfortunate life and deserves compassion. Emma has never felt so agitating, so mortified, and so grieved in her life, and she cries almost all the way home. Chapter 44. In this chapter, Emma reflects on party and she decides that the Box Hill party was a disaster. She still feels horrible about her act, and she visits Miss Bates the next day to make offense for her behavior, and she finds Jane sick with headache. Miss Bates tells Emma that Jane has decided to take Mrs. Elton's offer of a post of governess. Emma expresses surprise because Jane will leave within 2 weeks. She also surprised to learn that Frank departed the previous evening for Richmond, and she is struck by the difference between Mrs. Churchill's power and Jane's, and for the piano and nasty relationship she made between Jane and Mr. Dixon, she feels ashamed. Chapter 45. In Chapter 45 of Emma, Emma returns to Hartfield to discover that Mr. Knightley and Harriet have arrived in her absence. Knightley is about to depart for London to visit John and Isabella. His hastiness behavior surprises Emma. Mr. Woodhouse inquires about Emma's visit with Bates. Emma blushes and exchanges a glance with Knightley. She believes that he understands her feeling and forgives her. He makes an unusual gesture, taking her hand and almost kissing her. It is gratified. A little puzzled about his scruple in completing the kiss, the next day unexpected news arrives that Mrs. Churchill has died. At this, Emma thinks that this event may improve Harriet's chance with Frank. Emma attempts to provide assistance to Jane by inviting her to Hartfield and by sending her healthful foods and attempts to visit her. Jane pleads ill health, but Emma hears that Jane has been taking outside exercise and she feels hurt that Jane seems to be particularly avoiding her. Chapter 46. In this chapter of novel, Mr. Weston arrives to escort Emma to see Mrs. Weston. Assured that Mrs. Weston is well, Emma's first concern is for Isabella's family and for Mr. Knightley in London. But Mr. Weston assures her that the news does not involve them. At Randall's, Emma is greeted by Mrs. Weston, who explains that Frank has just revealed that he and Jane have been secretly engaged. At this, Emma is shocked, embarrassed by the things she said to Frank about Jane and concerned for Harriet's feeling. Emma quickly relieves Mrs. Weston by assuring her that she has no feelings for Frank. She is angry, however, about his behavior towards her and Jane. Mrs. Weston defends her stepson, telling Emma that there were misunderstandings between him and Jane, and that he will be writing her a letter detailing justifying circumstances. At the end of the chapter, Mr. Weston enters the room and Emma assures him that the news of Frank's engagement has not caused her any pain. Chapter 47. In this chapter, Emma is filled with concern for Harriet. She is angrier at herself than she is at Frank, because she believes that she should have discouraged Harriet's attachment to him. Jane's behavior since her arrival in Highbury is also put into perspective. Emma realizes that Jane has been avoiding her because she has seen her as a rival. Emma dreads telling Harriet the news, but when Harriet arrives at Hartfield, she has already heard the story from Mr. Weston. Emma is surprised at Harriet's action, and it turns out that Harriet never cared for Frank, but she has feelings for Mr. Knightley. She knows that Mr. Knightley is of higher rank than she, but she affirms that Emma has given her hope that she may raise herself enough to be acceptable to him. Here comes a twist in the story. When Emma finds herself in love with Mr. Knightley, she conceals her emotion from Harriet, asking Harriet whether she has reason to believe that Knightley returns her feeling. At this question, Harriet recounts a number of examples in which Knightley has shown her special attention. When Harriet departs, Emma is left to reflect that she has never been wrong about everything. Chapter 48. In Chapter 48 of Emma, Emma rethinks all of the events of the past month. She realizes it has always been important to her to be first with Mr. Knightley, and that he has always had special concern for her. But she cannot believe he could return her feelings, especially when he has just been so angry with her about her rudeness to Miss Bates. She still believes she would not marry him even if he asked, because she cannot leave her father. Now she has the opportunity to observe him and Harriet together. After this, Mrs. Weston arrives to report that she has just visited with Jane, and that Jane admitted to have suffered a good deal since entering into secret engagement. She blames herself for her misjudgment and acknowledges Emma's kindness during her sickness. Hearing this account, Emma again expresses anger for Mr. Frank's behavior, and Mrs. Weston again defends him. Chapter 49. In this chapter, Emma goes for a walk in the garden. To her surprise, Mr. Knightley joins her. He has just returned from London. She worries that Knightley will confess his feelings for Harriet, and she offers her news about Frank and Jane's secret engagement. But Knightley already knows about it. She assures him that she has never had feelings for Frank. She explains and expresses regret for her behavior, and Knightley is strangely silent. Finally, he admits that he may have underrated Frank and expresses envy at his circumstances. She worried that Knightley is about to discuss Harriet. Emma quickly silences him. He is mortified, and seeing his pain, Emma invites him to speak after all, saying she will be glad to hear him as a friend. But Knightley says he does not wish her friendship and declares his love for her. She is surprised, thrilled, and by the time they reach the house, they are engaged to Mary. Chapter 50. In chapter 50 of the novel, Emma can barely conceal her feelings as she and Mr. Knightley join her father for tea. That night, Emma lies awake worrying about Harriet and her father. She decides she will write a letter to Harriet explaining what has happened and arrange for Harriet to visit Isabella in London to give both of them some time to adjust to the new situation. She decides she and Knightley must postpone their wedding until after her father dies. Mrs. Weston forwards Emma a letter from Frank, which he explains all of his actions. He apologizes for his behavior and explains that he could tell Emma was not attached to him. He adores Jane. The couple Jane and Frank fight the morning of the Downwell Abbey because Jane was upset about his behavior towards Emma, and Frank was upset about Jane's caution. After that, Frank left for Richmond and Jane wrote a letter to him to break off the engagement. He received the letter from Jane the morning his aunt died, and he failed to send his response to her. She sent his letter back to him, indicating that he could return her letters at her governess post. This was the first news Frank had heard of her new position, and he threw himself at his uncle's mercy. Chapter 51. In chapter 51 of the novel, Emma, in her own happiness, cannot help but forgive Frank. When Knightley comes to her, she shares the letter with him. He reads the letter, telling Emma his impressions as he goes along, and he is less softened than her, but he is willing to admit that Frank has some good qualities. He and Emma discuss her father, and he agrees that Emma cannot leave Hartfield and that Mr. Woodhouse cannot be expected to move to Downwell Abbey. He suggests that he move to Hartfield and that Emma is moved by his sacrifice. She promises to think it over and soon likes the plan. In actual, her only sadness is that this engagement and relocation will estrange her and Harriet further. Chapter 52. In chapter 52 of Emma, Harriet agrees to Emma's plan to send her to London on the pretense that she needs to see a dentist, which satisfied Emma since she does not want to hurt Harriet with the news of Emma and Mr. Knightley's engagement. Emma decides not to tell her father of her engagement until Mrs. Weston, who is pregnant, has given birth to her baby. Meanwhile, she pays a visit to Jane. They are unable to speak openly because Mrs. Elton is there, and Jane's engagement is still supposed to be a secret. Emma interprets some of Mrs. Elton's remarks that indicates that Mrs. Elton is in on the secret of Jane and Frank's engagement. Mr. Elton turns up, annoyed that Mr. Knightley has missed a meeting with him. Emma decides he must be waiting for her at Hartfield and leaves. After that, Jane walks out and they both full of goodwill. Chapter 53. In Chapter 53 of Emma, Mrs. Weston safely delivers a baby girl, much to Emma's delight. Mr. Knightley's recall about how headstrong Emma was when she was a child. She expresses gratitude that he so often corrected her mistakes. Emma is grieved that she cannot speak more openly with him about Harriet. Mr. John Knightley congratulates Mr. Knightley and Emma on their engagement and shocks the couple by saying that he is not surprised by their news. Emma works up the courage to give her father the news. Mr. Woodhouse is shocked, but he gradually begins to resign himself to it. She is surprised and pleased by the match. Mr. Weston shares the news with Jane and Miss Bates, and soon Emma and Mr. Knightley's engagement is the talk of Highbury. Only the Eltons are displeased that Emma have made such a good match. Chapter 54. In this chapter, Mr. Knightley has news for Emma that Harriet is to marry Robert Martin. Knightley had sent Mr. Martin to London with the package for his brother while Harriet was there. Mr. Martin began to spend time with family. Knightley worries that Emma is upset, but in fact, she is thrilled, amazed, and amused at Harriet's rapid recovery. Emma is thankful that she has not done Harriet greater injury. She is glad that she will no longer need to conceal Harriet's emotional state from Knightley. Emma and Mr. Knightley go to visit Randalls and find Frank and Jane there. At first, Emma's meeting with Frank is awkward, but soon they are back on easy terms. Chapter 55. In the last chapter of Emma, Harriet returns from London. Emma is glad to see how completely she has recovered from her infatuation with Knightley. It is revealed that Harriet's father is a tradesman, a respectable person, but not the aristocrat that Emma had predicted. Emma receives Mr. Martin at Hartfield, but realizes that her friendship with Harriet must change into a calmer sort of goodwill because of their different social positions. Harriet and Mr. Martin are the first of the newly engaged couples to marry in September. Frank and Jane will be the last in November. Emma and Mr. Knightley would like to be married in October. The wedding is too modest to please Mrs. Elton, but the wishes, the hopes, the confidence, the predictions of the small band of true friends who witnesses the ceremony were fully answered in the perfect happiness of the union. Here is a critical commentary on the novel Emma from chapter 26 to onward. Jane Austen novel Emma appeared in 1813. Emma is generally considered as her greatest work. Emma ends in the traditional manner of comedy with a series of weddings to secure everyone's happiness and reaffirm social ties. In Jane Austen novel Emma, protagonist avoids her own transformation by her attempts to transfer others. In the novel, Jane reveals how self-transformation is necessary in maturing and establishing self-awareness. Austen uses Emma's progression to show that self-transformation does take time, but it is an essential step. Social status is also a prominent element in the novel. None of Austen's novel is as full of tricks as Emma. In these chapters or novels, the protagonist examines or notices the larger theme of community and class. Austen's novel of community While the circumscribed by geography ignores physical proximity as the sole determinant of neighborhood in favor of class discrimination. However, in the end, novel displays and upholds the value of marrying for love. Austen also gives many examples in her novel why the clarification is essential to understand each other. Austen also uses irony in the novel to show how marrying for love could be a cause of happiness. However, the journey there is perhaps not worth the suffering. Emma clearly displays constant example of all these values throughout the novel. I hope you will get the story of the novel. Thank you so much for watching.